We're glad to be sharing the ministry of Redemption Church with you. Now join us as we receive the Word of God.
Welcome to the Search Engine series at Redemption Church. Today, we answer your questions live. Text us in at 214-856-0550. Now we hand it over to Pastors Chris and Marshall to receive the Word of God in Q&A form.
Question number one for the day. Can a person lose their soul and still be alive?
Okay, so this sort of reminds me of, like, in TV shows and cartoons, a lot of times, like, a character will sell their soul, and then I'm particularly thinking of a Simpsons episode where Bart thought he lost his soul, and then the automatic doors at grocery stores wouldn't open for him anymore. And
like at a poo store?
Yeah.
It was probably a poo store, right?
And that's when he started to think, oh, I've made a terrible mistake.
Well, what's the movie where they, Freaky Friday, and they like... flip souls kind of a thing? Yeah. If you touch talismans and talk at the same time, I don't think that can happen.
So I guess in that circumstance, like the person lost their soul, if you sell your soul in exchange for... PS4 or something, would you survive? Is that a thing? Okay, so no. Not so much as, like, if someone takes your soul, you're like, oh, I can't breathe. Oh, in video games, too, that's always like a fatality.
Yeah? Mortal Kombat?
Shao Kahn, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Takes your soul, and that's how he kills you.
Gosh, we're the nerdiest pastors.
So I'm glad to inform you all about those things. So my understanding is that the soul isn't just a, like, sort of ghosty thing or like a spirity, like, thing that lives inside you. That's sort of how it's pictured a lot in TV. It can be a concept that's hard to understand. It's not real clear in the Bible what exactly is it, because there's the body. We know what that is. Mm-hmm. Got it. Spirit. Okay, that sounds like ghosty kind of stuff. And then soul as a separate thing, which one's which? And when you die, like, your soul goes to heaven, and what's that all about? Okay, my understanding is you've got a body. You've got a spirit, which is the immaterial part of you, all right? And those two together make up your soul. Your soul is your you, the wholeness of you. So, as I understand it, the word soul in the Bible, when you look back at the original language and what it comes from, it pertains to wholeness, that there's those two parts, and they get put together, make up the soul, so that in the new creation that we're all hopefully going to be at with Jesus, he gives us bodies and puts our soul back into, puts our spirit back into them. See, it gets real easy to get tripped up.
Over.
Put your spirit back in a new body for you, a new you body, and that's your soul. Then, and your soul does live with him, because God loves your body and your spirit. He loves all of you, and so he loves your soul. Can a person lose their soul and still be alive? Well, your soul is your you, so you can't really lose it. Like, it can get sort of broken into the two parts, mm-hmm. but... I can't trade you my soul, because it's all of me. If I don't have it anymore, I'm not me anymore.
Go back to Genesis. We know what happened. How does God make Adam? He forms him from the dirt of the ground, and so he forms a body. Then God breathes into the body. There's the spirit. You've got the body. You've got the spirit. And it said he became a
living soul.
He became a living soul. So there, I'm going to give you two ways to look at soul and spirit. We aren't really sure completely. The Bible's, it's really an interesting term. So you could think about them as three distinct things, or you can think about them kind of like a Venn diagram. This is what some scholars think. You've got the body right here, and you've got the spirit right here, and where they overlap, that is the soul. One thing is for sure, either way you look at it, you, when you lose your soul, when your soul leaves your body, you die. That's it. We've got a place in the Old Testament, prophet heals a boy, a boy's dead, and it says his soul came back into his body. That's what it says. The Bible talks about souls here. I'm sorry, my voice is a little ragged today. Thank you, Shelton. Everybody give Shelton a hand. God loves that guy. He's got a beautiful fiance. She's just a little blind, that's all. That's not true. She can actually see. She's very lovely, and he's a cool dude, and what a catch. All right, so we've got Jesus. He talks about what can a man give, or what profit is it to gain the whole world and lose your
soul.
Okay, so let me put you at ease here. We're not like dealing with one of the ghosty situations, or maybe a demonic possession kind of situation. Like maybe people are thinking, oh man, Satan's in my body and my soul, he's like kicked my soul out and now he's taken over. No, there is a thing of demonic possession, but that is always about you giving control to the enemy. And he, if you give enemy control, man, you don't just let him drive in the car, he ends up driving the car, right? You don't let him ride in the car, he'll drive the car. And so we're not talking about demonic possessions that they've lost their soul. That's not the case at all. So we are definitely, you cannot be alive and lose your soul. There's another place really prominent that talks about the soul, right? In heaven, we know about the altar of God, and underneath the altar of God are the souls of the
martyrs.
The saints or the martyrs. They've given their life for God. Are they alive or dead? Are they alive? Like half the church said, alive and dead. Let's split the church over this issue. Just kidding. No, we've got their body's dead, but the soul is eternal. The soul is going to spend eternity somewhere. Okay, heaven or hell. All right. If the body's there, that's a whole other thing. I do believe the body's in heaven. There's some people that don't believe the body's in hell, but that's another question technically. So the bodies of martyrs are down here on the ground. The soul's up there. God's going to resurrect them, and it's all going to come back together. Yeah. All right, so that's question one. That was a lot of information. Great question.
If you got further questions, because this is a big topic, what is a soul? How does that work? We, again, the text line's still open, so it'll take more than the time we have to.
I'm also covering that tomorrow in study group. We're talking specifically about the creation of Adam and Eve and becoming a soul.
Cool. Hashtag study group.
Hashtag study group. Question number two. I really dislike the Chewbacca mask video. Is there something wrong with me? You go.
Me? All right. So to be totally transparent, we're big on that here at Redemption Church.
Man,
I sent this question.
Whoa! You mean you don't like Chewbacca?
Oh, I don't have a problem with Chewbacca.
You don't
He's
like
cool.
Kohl's?
Kohl's, the store where she got the mask.
You don't like
okay.
Fun videos?
No, I hate
Are
fun videos.
Are you just heartless? I thought you were the care pastor.
I lost my soul and thus my ability to laugh at the Chewbacca mask video.
All right.
No. God loves you. I sent the question and I get to answer it too. This is awesome. You're actually better off if you don't like that video. How about that?
Raise your hand if you don't even know what that video is. We got a few people.
Sean. Sorry to call you out. You're on the internet now. But lady laughs her head off. It's good to laugh. It's good to be joyful. If you love that video, God bless you. If you don't, God still loves you.
I love that she's enjoying herself.
Yeah.
Hey, listen, you don't have to enjoy everything. There's a lot of Christian movies out there. Some of them I really enjoy. Some of them I don't enjoy all that much. Let me tell you, it's okay not to enjoy every sermon, except for ours, of course. But, like, I mean, there's some sermons that are, like, meat and potatoes, like you just need it, like more like vegetables. It's like, and then there's some sermons that are, it's okay. You don't have to, we don't all have to like the same things. By the way, the lady's a Christian and she's everywhere ministering right now. That we love. Way to go.
Yeah.
Cool. So question number three. I had a feeling that was you. All right. What is the Christian response to the Syrian refugee crisis? So let's explain the Syrian refugee. So there are these people fleeing Syria, and they're coming to a bunch of different nations. One of the nations that some of them have come to is the United States of America. And so there are people on both sides of the argument that say the major point of contention, I believe, is that some of these people could be terrorists, and so we have to be careful. And then, number one, let me jump to the end, like, to a real good point here. I don't like it when politics like uses religion and church to like prove its point. Yeah. Like you hear politicians, they only quote the Bible when it proves their point, but they still are philanderers. They're still liars and they're still cheaters. Come on, somebody. Do you not like that either? Am I the only one that don't? I don't like that. I don't like people quoting one part of the Bible and ignoring the other part. Like, well, I thought your Bible said to take care of the sick and the lame. Yes, it does. Let's have a Bible study. No, I just wanted to prove this one point. Okay, so here's what's the Christian response? But regardless, we got politics is going to do what politics do, right? But what should we do as Christians? Whatever situation we find ourselves, we should be thankful. That's something scriptural, right? Whenever we are in front of somebody that needs help, we should try to help them. In fact, there are people that will take from you, the Bible says, and what should you do? You should not ask for your stuff back. In fact, you should be helpful to them all the more. So the question, if you have a Syrian refugee in front of you, regardless of what you think they might be, number one, Christians shouldn't be racist. I'm going to say that a few more times so I get some amens. Christians shouldn't be racist.
Amen.
Christians should not be. All right, we should not be racist. So if we've got a Syrian person in front of us, it doesn't matter what their background. It doesn't matter if they're Muslim. It doesn't matter, you know, if they're Christian or if they're atheist or whatever. We should try to be Christ to them.
Yeah. All
right. Now, do we think Christ would say, what are you people doing here? You get out of here. I don't see that in the Bible. I don't see that. Now, let's speak to the other side of the issue about the terrorism. I get that. I kind of live here, and I don't like the idea of terrorists being here. So let me bring you one issue, one thought. You've got the New Testament church, right? They're being Jesus to the world. They're feeding widows and orphans. They're doing amazing works. But they're also being very wise. And you know what the fish looks like? What is the fish in Greek?
The ichthys.
The ichthys. I didn't want to say it wrong, so I knew he would know it. So you know where that symbol came from? You know the fish that you see on bumper stickers and stuff? It was a symbol that the early church would draw on the ground or they put somewhere for other Christians to identify themselves in time of persecution. So that they could come together and share Christ. And they had to be very careful with how they shared Christ, because if they are dead, they don't get to share Christ anymore. Right? Does that make sense? So they were bold, but they were also wise. We as Christians should be bold. We should also be wise. Okay? So that's my answer. You
okay.
Swing at it.
Again, this is sort of a big, complicated issue to...
Where are all the sweet little pretty questions, guys?
Like, I just sent the Chewbacca mask question.
Oh,
but anyway, so what is the Christian response to the Syrian refugee crisis? I'm not sure there is the response, and you have to do this, like, period, end of sentence. So as Chris said, we ought to have a heart for these people. God loves these people, regardless of background, race, religion, whatever. They are created in God's image. We should care about them. Second, I mean, one thing we can all do is pray for them, if nothing else. Have them in prayer that they would come to know Christ, that their needs would be met, that they'd get out of danger.
Let me stop you right there. Because every Christian goes, oh, well, yeah, of course we should pray. What should we really do? That's kind of the people think that way. No, you should pray. We should be praying for the Syrians long before they're trying to come here. Their nation is falling apart. We should be connected to the worldwide church of Jesus Christ. There are martyrs every day. We should be praying. Don't like look past, oh yeah, we should pray. That would be good. No, we should pray. Slap ourselves in the face because Christians don't pray today. Go ahead.
Amen. Thank you.
I had to do that.
And we should have a heart to help them. I mean, they're created in God's image. We care about them. God loves them. They're in desperate situations. I don't like that. I don't think God likes that. And a really convicting thing I heard recently was from a guy who lives in Turkey, and they've got some of the refugees there. He's a Christian, and so he would go and do work in the refugee camps and do things trying to help meet their physical needs, but also witness Christ to them. And one of the things he sort of complained about was people that are really, like, push back against them and just, oh, the refugees, brr, like, but are supposed to be Christians, that doesn't really help reach them for Christ. They do have needs. They do, and one of their needs is to get to know Christ. So you may not ever meet a Syrian refugee in person, or maybe you know like 10, but you can be in prayer for them, and when possible, share Christ with them. Now, we should have a heart to help them. What's the best way to help them? That's like a whole nother question that would take forever to answer, because that's big and complicated. It's a political issue. It's a geographical issue. There's a lot of things going on there. And God may call you to help them differently than he calls me to help them. If you know some Syrian refugees in your neighborhood, your response is different than mine, because I really don't personally know any. But, so, that's what I mean when I say there isn't necessarily one Christian response that everybody has to do the same thing. You should be open to God. You, as you're talking to God, if God convicts you that, hey, you need to be doing something about this, okay, well, what? And what is the best way to help them? If it's helping them come to America, okay. If it's helping them where they're at, or there's a lot of refugees in Europe and in that area because that's right next door and that's the easiest place for them to get to. Well, there's missionaries there that are trying to reach the refugees. I know some organizations. If you know missionaries or people that you want to support, you can help support them to help the missionary, to help the refugees. That's one way you can sort of directly impact them. But however it is, God may call you in a different way than he calls me, but you should be open to how God calls you to help anyone who needs help, including the refugees.
There's so much more we could say about this. I will only say one thing. Here it is. Whenever something happens on the global scale, like an earthquake in Nepal or a typhoon, or some cataclysmic thing, right? Christians should do something about it from all over the world. I think that's scriptural. There's a place in Acts where they do that. They send an offering from Antioch to Jerusalem to help Jerusalem during a time of famine. But when you see news of other places in the world, you're like, oh man, that's really terrible. Move on to something else. Like, we are some of the most rich people on the face of the planet, if you look globally, and we're Christians who know about giving. There ought to be something in us as a church. We'll just say it like it is. As a church, Redemption Church, we ought to hear about a global thing, or even in our backyard, like where Rowlett was hit with a tornado over Christmas break. We ought to come together as a church and find something to do. Maybe we can't give thousands of dollars. Maybe we can give 100. Do you know how much $100 would help someone in Nepal? Do you know what that would do? It's amazing. You can do something, and God's calling all of us to do something. So right now, as a church, I'm telling you, hold us accountable to that, because that should be in our heart. That should be in our vision to be Jesus to the world.
One other thing. I know we're trying to move and keep it going. Sort of a tangential issue. Here's something that should not be part of the Christian response to the refugee crisis or anything else. Like, the refugee crisis has become kind of a political issue.
Totally.
And anything like that becomes something for people to fight about, especially online or in person. The Christian response should not be to, like, blow somebody up on social media, like, using hateful words and calling them names, and no matter what side of it you're on, you can disagree. That's perfectly fine. But we ought to disagree in love.
Amen.
No matter what we're doing.
Cool. Question four. Great question. All right. What is the meaning of sin leading to death versus sin not leading to death in 1 John 5:16, verse 17? Oh boy, oh boy. Anybody know where this is headed already? Let's look at those verses. This is some major stuff. Read that for us.
If anyone sees his brother commit a sin that does not lead to death, he should pray, and God will give him life. I refer to those whose sin does not lead to death. There is a sin that leads to death. I am not saying that he should pray about that.
Verse 17.
All wrongdoing is sin, and there is sin that does not lead to death.
All right. It's like, what is this about? So let me first start about this. You're not going to get an exact answer from us on this, because most people don't completely agree on it. I can give you a ballpark, I think, a good response to it, though. Let me first say, this is what it doesn't mean. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. Any sin will take you to death, right? And the second death, the Bible talks about the second death. What is that? Hell. That's hell. By the way, the word death here in 1 John 5 is the same word used for the second death. These are the exact same very generic term for the soul leaving the body, death kind of a thing. So there is a sin that leads to death and a sin that doesn't lead to death, okay? So what does that mean? Number one, it's not the sin thing. Like, there's some sins that are worse than others, that this sin, sure, I sin, but that won't take me to hell. No, sin is serious. You need to repent of all sin. You need to let Jesus take you out of sin. That's why he went to the cross, to take away our sin. So here's some things to think about. These are some things that scholars think about. By the way, I've asked this question most of my time doing ministry. Like, what are hard questions, like, doing ministry? This is like at the top of the heap. Congratulations, whoever asked this. All right. There is a place in the Old Testament where they gave a bunch of laws. And there were some laws that if you broke them, immediate death. Okay, so some people look at that. There's some people that look at New Testament situations tied in with that, with Ananias and Sapphira. Anybody know about Ananias and Sapphira? Early parts of Acts, we're looking like Acts chapter 4, 5, somewhere in there. Ananias and Sapphira lied. They said, hey, we just sold all our property, and here's all the money for what we gave. See what I did there? I took some of the money, and they didn't give all the money, but they said they did. And guess what? Both of them dropped dead because they lied to the Holy Spirit. So some people think there's a situation here. There's some things that are so serious, God will just kill you on the spot for it. I won't disagree with that. There's things that happen that way. But let me also say this. Sometimes that's merciful, which it doesn't sound merciful, does that? Like, well, God just killed them. He didn't even give them a space. But also, let's flip it around. God also didn't give an opportunity for them to keep going the direction they were going. What if God would have just said, no, I'm merciful, I won't do anything. I won't do anything. Oh, God, they're not even believing him anymore. It could happen that way. And I don't know when it happens that way, but maybe it does happen that way, that God takes some people because they're going the absolute wrong direction, that they would lose their entire soul, which is not merciful at all, right? So there's that. Here's what I think it is, okay? Here's what I really think it is, but you don't have to look very far to find somebody that disagrees with me, right? All that being said, there is blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, right? Which is a very misunderstood question. We've had that in years past. Let me tell you, blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is an unforgivable sin, it says. The reason I believe it's unforgivable is because it's all about the heart of a person. If a person commits any sin, like I do drugs, is that a sin? Yeah. I cheat on my wife, is that a sin? Yeah. I speed, is that a sin? No. Yeah, it is. All right, forgive me. I forgot to repent before I started. Just drove in from Arlington, guys. All right, but there is, God can forgive those sins. Can God forgive every sin? It says he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins if we will confess them. So what is this sin that says it's unforgivable? Let me tell you, I believe that the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit is a sin where you say, I no longer believe in Jesus. If you make the sin of saying, I no longer believe in Jesus, you are going this direction in life, there is no forgiveness for you. The only forgiveness you could ever have is if you turned around and started believing in Jesus again. Do you see that? So there are certain situations in life where people blaspheme the Holy Spirit. Let me throw out two examples that go with the idea of blaspheming the Holy Spirit. We go back to Jeremiah, I believe it's Jeremiah 18, where God says, go down to the potter's house and I will show you something. And he goes down there and there's this potter working. And he says, this clay is Israel. And as long as they will let the potter work on them, that there's hope for them. He will make them into something. God is the potter. But if they will not allow him to work on them, they become dry and brittle, then he will have to set them aside. He can't use them. He will actually have to throw them into the fire. That looks like hell, right? So what is that? That is making the sin where you no longer are open to God, where you are moldable to him. There's another thing. We talk about unforgivable sins. Here's one. If you don't forgive, you can't be forgiven. If you make this is a heart decision. These are things that will lead nowhere else but to death. So there's just some things right there. I think they're heart conditions. Last thing, most people ask this question because they're afraid they committed that sin. Most people ask, what is blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? Because I'm afraid I did it, right? I just drove on 75, I-75, I probably did it five times. Hey, no, if you are even asking it, if you're even worried about it, you haven't done it. The person that's done it doesn't even care. They're like, God's over there, forget him, expletive words at him. I don't need him, I don't want to hear about him, I don't care if I blasphemed him. That's the person that blasphemed the Holy Spirit. That's the person that's on their way to death.
So, amen. All right. So here's a couple more ways you could take these verses. If you look at them in sort of a strictly literal sense, say you know a person who's addicted to drugs. They take a whole bunch of drugs and it puts them in the hospital, but they don't die. Well, we should be praying for them that they would stop that sin. Yep. In case you didn't know, doing drugs is a sin. So we pray for them. God, help them, bring them out of this. Lord, yes. Save them from that and everything else. But if they overdose and pass away, move on. Pray for somebody else. There's still people alive who need your prayers. Don't get fixated on, oh man, this person, maybe they were special to you, but that's kind of over and done with. When David, when his child with Bathsheba died, he got up and cleaned himself off and moved on. So that's one way you could take it. Another much more compelling interpretation I read of this is that he's talking about sin leading to death, sin that doesn't lead to death. As Chris said, the sin that leads to death ultimately is not trusting in Christ and asking him to forgive you and save you, that not coming to faith in him. So what the study that I heard on this said, not that we can't pray for people that don't know Christ. We obviously can. We just told you with the Syrian refugees. We hope that they do. We can't pray that God would just like bend the rules for them and like, even if they don't come to faith in you, Jesus, like just kind of let them in anyway, please. Could you maybe? No, we shouldn't. God doesn't do that. That's not how it works. So we can't pray for that. The sin that doesn't lead to death, hey, I know Christ. I still sin. Well, but it's not a, oh, you're off the team. You messed up. Too bad. Get out.
Yeah.
No, God is faithful and just to forgive our sins if we repent and come to him and say, hey, I've still messed up.
Yeah.
Please forgive me. And so we can pray for one another.
We that, should
and, pray for one another. And it says God will give them life. That's what he does.
Very good. Let's look at that verse 16 one more time. So what we were saying about like blaspheme of the Holy Spirit being a reprobate is another term for not being moldable anymore. It tells us not to pray for them if they've committed a sin that leads to death. I think that's the biggest clue about it, right? If that person has said, I'm turning away from Jesus, Jesus has done everything he can to save that person. In fact, if Jesus were to, there comes a moment where if Jesus is to do one more thing for that person, the only thing left would be to like supersede their will and make them turn around.
That's right.
Right? He's not going to do that. You have to make up your own mind. It's a free choice that he's given everybody. Whosoever would believe on him shall have everlasting life. So he's not going to turn them around. So guess what? If you're praying for them, it's a waste of time. That's what he's saying. They've made their choice. It's up to them. Once they start going like this, well, maybe I'm going to reconsider. Pray for them all over the place. But the person that has turned themselves, I'm totally against the Lord. God's done everything he can. He is waiting for them. And he will wait until the very end. The prodigal son is an example of that. So, there.
So just to, not to disagree, but we don't always know who is completely set. So in general, don't give up on people. They may seem pretty like adamantly opposed. We can't pray that God would just zap their brains and suddenly
turn them into robots that are Christians.
Oh, I have to love God now.
Lord, let them wake up with a WWJD bracelet on.
But we could pray, even if they are in this reprobate spirit headed away from God, that God would open doors or use things in their life to help guide them back, to open their eyes, to help them out of this. We don't always know. We can't see people's spirits like God can. So don't just write people, I'm pretty sure he's got a reprobate spirit, so I'm not going to pray for him anymore. You don't know that.
Correct. Next question. Moving on. Question 5. If God knows what we need, why do we need to pray?
Why do we need to pray at all? He already knows. What are we doing? Why didn't I think of that?
All right. So God knows what the Bible says is God knows our needs before we ask. There's several reasons why you need to pray. Number one, one of the overlooked ideas of prayer is agreement. What happened to Adam and Eve with the serpent in the Old Testament and early books of Genesis was really that they got out of agreement with God and started agreeing with the enemy. Prayer is an opportunity to turn away from the enemy and get back in agreement with God. One of the most powerful ways to pray is to open up your Bible and to like find somewhere in the Psalms where there's like a song about Israel. And take out the word Israel and put who you're praying in the scripture. And God, you know, God be faithful to Israel, Patricia. God, bring her back unto you and protect her and build her up. And so now we're praying that way. Really what we're doing there is we're coming to agreement with Scripture. We're coming in agreement with God. God knows our need, but we don't know our needs. And so we need to ask God to lead us and show us what we need. It's one of the reasons.
So, yeah, I mean, okay, if God knows what we need, why do we need to pray? Because we need to pray. It's for us. It helps us. There's sort of a misunderstanding built into this question that prayer is just asking for stuff. Yes. And God knows what we need anyway, so why do we have to ask him? That isn't all prayer is. Mm-hmm. A big part of prayer is thanking him for the things that he's done and will do and is doing right now. And, I mean, doesn't he already know I'm grateful for it? Well, sure. I mean, but if you gave me something and wouldn't you know I'm going to be grateful for it? It helps if you say it. It helps if you express it. Yeah. Part of prayer is worship. Lifting him up and just speaking out how good God is. Yeah. We need to do that periodically. We need to do that all the time to remind ourselves, if nothing else. So we need to pray because it works in our life as it brings us into agreement with God.
We come and pray and we're like, God, I need this thing. But really, God, we need you. And you're only going to have him and the things you need if you have a relationship with him. Did you get that?
And when we do need to ask for things or feel that we need to ask for things, it helps us too because it can give us a new perspective on that situation. We might come into it thinking, oh, I need this thing. Well, if we really start talking to God about it, maybe we don't necessarily need that thing, maybe that wouldn't really fix the bigger problem. And God can help us and work in us and through us to realize that, no, there's something else going on here. And we can address that and start working on that and really make an impact in this problematic situation.
Yeah, absolutely.
But it starts by opening up your heart and communicating with God.
One of the hardest things to do is to pray for somebody that's praying for the wrong thing. I've been at altars before where somebody prays, man, I need God to not let me go to jail. And I was like, I was brokenhearted because I started to pray that, you know, they wouldn't go to jail, and it just hit me. No, they're supposed to go to jail. I'm like, I'm supposed to tell them that? They weren't very happy about that. But I said, listen, maybe it's not God's will that you get off scot-free. But maybe it's God's will that you do reap what you sow. But right here, you find the strength that will take you through this, and you're a changed person, and you don't have to live with the guilt anymore, and God can do that in your life. So it's not always fun being a pastor praying with people. All right, question 6. Oh, man, that's for you to read.
Okay. The Bible says that it is better to lose a limb than to have it help you to sin. Why are there not more Christians with less limbs? Furthermore, if I am addicted to pornography, would it be better to cut my hand off than to continue to sin? I understand a moderate viewpoint of receiving help/healing to break addiction, but what if we died in a car accident on the way home? Wouldn't a lost limb be better than eternal damnation?
Well, a lost limb would definitely be better than eternal damnation. So Jesus says, you know, if your eye offends you, pluck it out. If your hand offends you, cut it off, because it's better to enter into eternity without these things, right? So number one, okay, the Bible can be absolutely taken literal, and some people would take this literal. I'm pretty sure he's speaking in hyperbolic language here, because when you go into eternity, you're restored. You don't have an eye plucked out. You don't have a hand cut off. He's telling you, you better make a choice, because the choice that you're making in sinning could cost you eternity. Make that choice, and that choice is as serious as losing your hand. Could you imagine having a blade and about to, you couldn't hardly do that, right? I mean, there's that one movie where he gnaws off he's in a mountain.
Yes, I know that movie.
148 hours? 128 hours.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. James Franco, yeah.
Yeah, so anyway, it would be really hard to do. He's really telling us to make a decision. Number one, you shouldn't ever have to cut off your hand to stop sinning. Here's an idea. Here's the real key to sin. Most of my life, I messed up. I was like, I need to stop sinning to make God happy. And I messed up again. I'm angry, God. I'm so sorry. It wasn't until I said, you know what? I'm going to love God instead of sinning that it became easier to defeat some of those sins. So I came to that fork in the road of, am I going to sin or am I going to love God? And man, that's a lot more than just making God happy. That's like, God, I love you. I'm going to pray. And so I replaced those things that were sin with things that were actively loving God. I'm going to study Scripture. I'm not going to be by myself where I will fall into that sin. I am going to go do ministry. I'm going to hang out with some other Christians or anything else other than that thing. But what I'm actually doing is not trying to abstain from sin as much as I'm trying to actively love God. Do you see that picture? All right, so actively love God. Do that.
So, yeah, I agree. I think Jesus wasn't literally talking about cutting off your hands or plucking out your eyes. He's saying that if you have a sin problem in your life, you might have to cut some things out of your life to address that, to help with that. Let's talk about drastic versus easy and effective versus not effective. Ideally, we'd want to start addressing any problem with sort of the easiest things we could do that would be most effective, all right? Would we all agree that cutting off a hand or some part of your body, that would tend to be toward the drastic end of the spectrum, right?
Yeah.
Okay, well, in this situation, if you have an addiction to pornography, before you start and cut off part of your body, why don't you cut off your internet connection to your house if it's really that big of a problem?
I mean, somebody comes in with a nub and says, now he tells me.
Yeah. Hey, better late than never.
Oh, I could have gotten an accountability partner?
Yes. They make software now. There's incredible things. There's a lot you can do to address this. But you might have to cut some stuff out of your life to help prevent you from falling back into it. All right? So then what's effective versus not effective? Sin is a heart issue. It's not an eyeball issue. It's not a hand issue.
No, it's a heart issue.
You can cut off your hand and still have a problem.
Yes.
So, I mean, you can go to this drastic measure and it might not fix it. What we need to do is turn towards God. Reach out to Him first, because He can work in us and help us to change our heart, to repent and turn away from that thing and turn back towards Him.
Yeah.
Repentance might not always be super easy. I'm not trying to say, oh, it's like falling off a log. But it's a lot easier than trying to cut off part of your body.
Amen.
We turn to Jesus, and let me tell you, that's the most effective thing. That's the A number one. He can change things when nothing else can. So we don't see more people with missing hands and eyes because God's got something more effective than that.
Yeah. The mark of a Christian is not somebody that's being maimed by Christ, but being healed by Christ.
Amen.
Next question. It's like question 7, verse 7. Okay. The Bible models how we should deal with persecution, but groups like ISIS, a terroristic group, are seeking eradication. What is a realistic viewpoint for dealing with extermination? Do we fight back? How do we turn the other cheek until death? Okay, well, this is a tough question. We've answered some questions like this before in the past. It's always a hard question. There's some people that will go to the extreme of pacifism, where they don't even defend themselves. And I don't go that far, but I feel like I'm kind of in the middle. You have the right to defend yourself. You have the right to defend others. You have the right to defend your family. I I'm not a big fan of military, except in the idea of the military defending people and rescuing people. And when you couch it like that, if you have the idea of military, we're going to go out there and just wipe out all those awful people, nasty people, and like stereotype everyone there. I'm not a big fan of that. But if you talk about the military going in there and stopping those that want to harm others and destroy others, that I'm a big fan of. Do you see that? Do you see the difference in that? So I'm all for defending ourselves against prayer is our weapon of mass destruction. You want to really, we don't drop nuclear bombs. We pray and mountains move. We pray and lives are changed. We pray for our enemies and we see our enemies come to Christ. There are countless testimonies about it. Saul of Tarsus is not the only person that has ever worked on. That works on many, many, many people. It works on us. It worked on some of us, brought us to the Lord.
Let's say it's our weapon of mass construction.
Construction.
It's destructive to the works of the enemy, but
yes.
Ultimately God builds things up. But, yes. So yeah, okay.
Thank you, Lord.
I understand where you're coming from with this. You might be worried. ISIS, some groups want to wipe out anybody who's of a different faith and till it's just them because they're right. Okay, well, whatever. What is a realistic viewpoint for dealing with extermination? So you hear them, you're worried about this, and you're like, oh man, we're at war, and they're seeking to wipe us out. Well, what do we do? Like, but Jesus says, turn the other cheek. I'm worried. Okay, be at peace. Even if their set purpose and entire design is on wiping out Christians, don't worry about it. Don't worry about that. You believe the Bible, right? We believe we know the answer. And God's real and all the stuff, right? You think he's going to let all Christians get wiped out? Yeah, we know the end of the book. So,
newsflash, people have tried to wipe out Christians. They've tried to wipe out Jews. They never have succeeded.
So, at least in that, be at peace. Now, you got groups doing awful things. Things that
need to be stopped.
I don't even want to think about them. I try and push them out of my brain because they're so awful. It's ridiculous. And I think it's fair to want to try to stop them from doing these things. Sometimes they're doing them to Christians. That's awful. But thank God that the person they did it to knows Christ, at least.
Amen.
They're doing these awful things to other Muslims, to people of other faiths. I mean, stop it. I want that to stop. Now, military, as Chris said, again, what's the best way to help with that? I don't know. But prayer is an effective weapon. We fight not against flesh and blood, but against powers and principalities. And here, me in North Texas, I'm not part of the military. What am I going to do? I can pray, and God can do things. So do we fight back? When given, I don't think we need to fight back for ourselves. Like, if someone comes in and is attacking just us.
Like we attack for revenge. That's
personally,
that's
we don't need to, like, oh, no, I'll show you and I'll kill you. No. But if they're attacking other people, it's okay to try to defend them and preserve life.
All right. So Jesus is obviously our example, right? And Jesus, man, did people seek to destroy him? Did they destroy him? They killed him. They put him in the grave. He never fought back. We have the picture of martyrs. We have a wonderful story of a martyr named Polycarp. Polycarp, fascinating story. He is tied to a stake, and they are about to burn him alive. And he starts singing praises to God as he dies. And guess what? He doesn't die from the flames. The flames don't engulf him. they end up having to take his life another way. But he, you know, he didn't lean over and say, "Hey, I'm going to make a run for it. Let's put a distraction. You know, you distract him over here, and we'll run away." No, that wasn't his plan. If they take our life, they can take our kill our body, but they can't kill our soul. Our soul goes to the Lord. All right, the Bible. Speaking of soul and body scriptures, there's one. Jesus says, don't fear the person that can destroy your body. Fear the person that can destroy the soul. All right, so that's kind of how we feel about that. Question 8. If I preach and champion God's forgiveness, then if someone rapes and murders my child, is it my responsibility to drop charges and let God's justice be enough? All right, so this is really tough, okay? The Bible tells you that you need to forgive, right? And this is such an extreme situation, right? I'm not trying to make light when I say you need to forgive that person. But you need to find forgiveness in your heart. I think you need to forgive God. Not that God did it. But you say, God, I know you didn't do it. I set you free. And I know it was never your plan to do this. I think it's really important that your heart comes to that conclusion, yeah. Right? Can y'all agree with that? Yeah. I hate to see people come to the conclusion that God did that. You need to pray that God would help you forgive that person. Now, forgiveness and restoration are two different things. You're commanded to forgive. You aren't really commanded to restore people. As in, I forgive that person, restoring them would be, say, I'm going to drop all charges against them. Now, if the Lord tells you to do that, if you feel like doing that, I don't understand that, but that's between you and the Lord. But there's a difference between forgiveness and restoration. You're completely in your rights to let the justice system move on, but you need to look out for the injury in your heart, because even if they go to an electric chair, your heart could be filled with just such hatred that would take you down some bad paths in life. Yeah. Hatred never takes you toward happiness. Forgiveness will, though. Yeah.
So, I agree with that. Is it my responsibility to drop charges? No. It's your responsibility to forgive them. And ideally, we would hope that it's difficult, but somebody wrongs you, even in a terrible way, we hope that we'd be able to forgive them and still want the best for that person. Well, okay, let's take this particular situation. This is a horrible, gnarly situation. Somebody rapes and murders my child. Well, just letting them go free probably isn't the best thing for that person. They've got something way wrong inside of them, and they need help. So just dropping the charges and going off like it never happened, that's not going to help them. And that's not going to help other people around them. So as Chris said, we need to make sure we can forgive them, but then we don't have to just drop charges and restore them and let them go back to being whoever. They need help.
Yeah, I remember there was a woman that was on death row, and it was during the time that George W. Bush was the governor of Texas. I don't remember this lady's name.
Carla
something.
Carla Faye
Tucker, all right. So Carla Faye Tucker came to the Lord, all right? Praise God. She's on death row. She came to the Lord. Then a lot of Christians said, she's come to the Lord, Brother Bush. You're the governor of Texas, and you're also a Christian. You need to pardon her. Pardon her. She's a sister in the Lord. And I just don't see that, guys. It didn't happen. And Carla went on to be with the Lord. She paid for her crimes. The government decided that's how it needs to be. And so we let Caesar dictate the things of the government, all right? But again, I believe Carla's with the Lord. I don't think Governor Bush was in the wrong there to let the justice system play out the penalty, reaping what she sowed, all right?
Yeah.
It's a great question. If you ever, if you like need to talk about that, like, because there's areas of your life you were hurt and it haunting you, you need to talk to somebody.
I know people who have been wronged in a way that's much less than what's described in this question, but they can't let it go. Mm-hmm. And they're gonna hang on to that till they're deep in the cold, cold ground because that person did this thing. And I mean, to them, it's a major thing, but hearing about it, it seems no matter what anyone does to you, it's crucially important that we be able to forgive them. Yes. Jesus even tells us to pray, God, forgive my sins as I forgive other people.
Yeah. God's justice will be served. Is God's justice enough? Well, God's justice is going to be served. Now you need to focus on your heart. One more thing. I remember the Trayvon Martin. Thank you. Trayvon Austin's a football player. All right, Trayvon Martin. All right, Trayvon Martin, that whole case came out, and I remember I had one friend talk to me online, and they were an African-American family, and her son came to her and just really afraid. It's like, I think anyone could kill me, and what am I supposed to do about that? Anyone could kill me and get away scot-free. And she's like, what do I even tell my boy? And I was like, I don't know everything about this case. I'm not going to tell you if the justice system was right or wrong. But let me tell you, no one gets away with anything on God's watch.
Amen.
You tell him that. You tell him that God's always his safety. You tell him that. You tell him that if that guy did what he did to Trayvon Austin, even if Trayvon Martin, even if that justice system failed there, God's justice system does not fail. And also tell your boy we need to be on the right side of God's justice system. All right, question 9. We got one? All right. Was Jesus a subpar carpenter? I'm going to say that Scott Fain sent this one in. Scott Fain is one of the funny things. We had a theological discussion once on the Bible never says that Jesus was an excellent carpenter. And so that one of the terrible ideas that we came up with that we shot down and didn't do, we were going to do a skit where Jesus was a bad carpenter. So that's probably, we don't know. So to answer this like it's a serious question, which it might be if it is, I'm sorry. We don't know if he was like the greatest carpenter in the world, but I bet he had a good work ethic. Yeah. I believe he cared. I believe he listened to his earthly father, Joseph, who made his living as a carpenter. All right, so imagine he didn't make no junk. God don't make no junk. Yes, so question 10. That wasn't you, was it?
No.
All right, question 10. Moving on, question 10. What are wise things said in the Bible? There's a whole book of them. It's called?
Proverbs.
Next question. No, I mean, there's a lot of questions there. There are things we can get from Jesus all over the place. He says, don't worry about tomorrow. Don't put all your worry about tomorrow and let that be in today. Worry about today. You've got to be in the moment, right? You see stuff like that all over the internet. That came from Jesus. Be in the moment. Is that some wisdom? Yeah. Right? Self-control. The Bible talks a lot about self-control. It says that a person without self-control is like a house, is like a city that's got no defenses. And the enemy is just going to run right through them. That's some good wisdom. It's good wisdom all throughout it. Start with Proverbs.
So, yeah. A better question might be, what are some unwise things said in the Bible? And because that'd be a much shorter answer. In 1 Timothy, or is it 2? It's chapter 3, verse 16. Every word is God-breathed.
Uh-huh.
Is it 1 or 2, Clyde? You know?
2, right? Second.
Okay, I'll go with that. Every word is God-breathed and profitable for teaching and admonishment and
rebuking, reproof.
So and so. Every word of the Bible is good for something. It's all got wisdom in it. The trick is understanding it and applying it right. We've been tossing around a Connect Group series called Don't Quote Me, because there's some chapters and sections of the Bible that you can't just throw them out, directly quote them, and act like, yeah, it means exactly what it says. Blessed is he who throws your little ones on the rocks. That's in there. That's in the Psalms.
In Psalms. Somebody sang that.
There's more to it. You got to understand the context.
You have to understand the context.
But there it is. It is 2 Timothy.
And if you want to know the context, that's a question, y'all.
So that's why we need to study it and be well-versed in the Bible. Hashtag study groups on Monday nights. If you want to know more, if you're interested in a particular piece of wisdom or something there, feel free to get in touch with us.
If anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask God who gives generously to all who ask.
That's right.
It's somewhere in the Bible, James, I believe.
Yes.
Moving on. The woman who memorized all the book of James knows. All right. So next question, question 11. Does the Bible explain things in certain expressions? So what I think this means is the Bible always literal? Sometimes it's literal, sometimes it's figurative, sometimes it's metaphorical. All the parables are stories that they represent symbolically some things, right? Like a woman that loses a coin, all right? The woman, we understand, but that coin, that's something precious, and that coin is Christ, right? That coin is what's important right there. And there's a treasure in the field, and what's that treasure? And we can go on all that. So there are expressions in the Bible there.
Yes, Jesus even makes it clear. He explains some of his proverbs and says, okay, in this, the seed is the word of God, and the sower is the person spreading the word of God. And so the ones that fell here were this, and the ones, yes, obviously he's using sort of a metaphorical speech.
Absolutely.
I believe there are some, like, sort of idiomatic things. They, like, it's hotter than a
furnace out here. It's harder than a...
Yeah, okay, that's one. We say that.
Harder than a pig.
It's hotter than a furnace. If someone said that, that doesn't mean it's literally, like,
yes,
thousands of degrees outside.
Yeah.
We say that to express it is very hot outside right now. Well, they had expressions like that back in biblical time, and sometimes they work into the Bible, and when you read it, it can give you kind of a weird, like, huh? Mm-hmm. But scholars have worked through it and gotten to what they were really trying to convey through these words. Again, this is why Bible study is important, and working through it, not just, I'm going to read through it on my own, and whatever it says, whatever I interpret it to mean, that's good enough. No, we got to do our faith together, study the Bible together.
Dig deep.
Build up our understanding. Iron sharpens iron.
Yes. Cool. Question 11 or 12. I think he's renumbered them. All right, so we're right now. Question 12. According to the prophecy, Jesus needed to spend 3 nights in the tomb. He also 3 days and 3 nights in the tomb, in the belly of the earth there. Does that mean he died on a Friday? All right, so let's look up that scripture. Do we have that scripture there, Rob? Matthew chapter 12, verse 40. For as Jonah, this is Jesus speaking, was 3 days, everyone said 3 days.
3 days.
And 3 nights, everyone said 3 nights.
3 nights.
In the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days.
3 days.
And 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Okay, so when we... Most Christians celebrate Good Friday. So let's count this up. So if we take this verse literal, number one, I'm going to talk about this verse for a second. I'll give you, in the end, 3 ways that are interpreted on this verse, all right? But let's go with the absolute literal. The first one is literal. So if he was killed on Friday on the cross in the daytime, so 3 days, there's one day, Friday night, Saturday night, and he rose Sunday. Did I do that right?
Yeah.
So that's not 3 and 3. Do you get that?
Right.
So that's like 2 nights and 3 days. You feel that? So So we'd be taking that literal. Then you'd have to go back to like he was on the cross on a Thursday. Right? So there are some people, I know we talk about some of them even in this own church, about they believe that Jesus died on the cross on Thursday. And so I see that in this interpretation, and I'm open to it. By the way, if anybody wants to have a good Thursday service, sure, let's do it. What I really want to do is celebrate a risen Savior and what he did on the cross, and we should actually do that every day. All right? We don't celebrate Good Friday because somebody somewhere said we need to do that. We should celebrate that every day. And if, you know, it's great when we come together and do that. So there's Thursday. I totally can see Thursday. Number one, this is like not a deal breaker for either of us. It's not a deal breaker at Redemption Church. So Thursday, could he have been on the cross on Thursday? Could he have been on the cross on Friday? Let me give you another interpretation of that. And it's not that it's literal, but it's idiomatic language. There is a way of date keeping in Judaism that if you experience part of that year, they counted all of that year. If you experienced part of the day, you experienced all of the day. Does that make sense? So if Jesus died like 1 hour before nightfall, they would account that as he spent all of the day Friday on the cross. Does that make sense? Or in the tomb, I should say, in the tomb. So that would say all of Friday, and he spent all of Saturday, and he rose Sunday morning by Jewish standards in this interpretation. That would mean all of the day. So instead of speaking of literal 3 days, 3 nights, it was idiomatic language that could be parts of a day equals a day. So part of Friday would still be all of Friday. Part of Sunday would be all of Sunday. That would still be 3 days. It wouldn't disqualify his prophecy, all right? I'm cool with that way of interpreting it. Another way is that it's 72 hours. I know some people that even go as far back maybe as Wednesday as that was the day he was on the cross, all right? So then that's 72 hours. So they're not only just taking into account 3 days, 3 nights, but actually three 24-hour periods, all right? Which one's correct? I don't know. Also, your Bible doesn't clearly say. It says that he was found on Sunday morning.
That's right.
And that's what we celebrate. We aren't looking for reasons as believers in Christ to separate ourselves and like argue and debate and contend with each other. The Bible talks about contention. It says that we should contend for the faith that was delivered to the saints. If we have any contention, it's that we got to keep the faith, brother, right? But what happens sometimes in Christianity is like a contention of, well, I serve Jesus this way, and it's obviously better than the way you serve him, right? And that's like how we contend. And so this question, not that someone asked it that way, but this question, some people could be contentious about it, all right? We have no such contention about it. He rose, and we celebrate it. That's what we believe above all. Anything to say about that?
Amen. Well, we celebrate the fact that he's alive, right?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
So, Good Friday, we don't really celebrate that he died.
We remember.
We remember that he died. He died for us. But we don't, it's not super important that it be on a specific day. I mean, that what day you celebrate that on doesn't determine the final destination of your soul.
Yeah.
The fact is, he died. We know that. We should all be in agreement about that.
Yes, God.
He went into the tomb.
Yes.
And then he rose again.
Yes.
And amen. Praise God. He's alive today. Hallelujah. That's awesome. If the exact workings of that start to divide us and like cause arguments and hurt feelings and we step on each other's toes and stuff, it's not profitable. We're not helping anybody with that.
Amen.
I have a thing that I believe about this. I'll talk to you in person about it if you're interested, but we don't have a whiteboard available here, so I can't really totally
Thursday, he believes Thursday.
Lay it all out. But the important thing is we're in fellowship. that we believe he's alive, and we don't seek to be right to the exclusion of being each other's brothers and sisters, caring and loving for one another.
There's some places in Christianity you need to correct, like the beliefs of other people. It, like if they are incorrectly no longer believing in Jesus, you should speak to that. But there's some areas in this we shouldn't like look to henpeck each other or correct each other on. We should just celebrate the Lord. We shouldn't argue over every little thing. And I've known some churches that do that, okay? Y'all have all heard about the church that split over the argument of did Adam have a belly button or not? Yeah. They're like, well, he obviously didn't have a belly button. They're like, how dare you say that? And they split the church right there. That is ridiculous. It would not be glorifying to God if we like split over something the Bible doesn't even tell us directly. It doesn't say, and on Thursday he gave up the ghost. It doesn't say that, so why should we make a big deal of it, right? So there's and where there's room for interpretation, there should be room in how we deliver that.
That's right.
We shouldn't deliver it as, and if you don't believe it this way, there's the door. No. No, no way, no way, no way. Okay? Got another question, Rob? That was a great question. We got three questions? Oh. All right, here we go. Why is doing drugs a sin?
Boom. Okay, I said that. Here's why. So, obviously, drugs, according to the drug abuse DARE, was a program when I was in elementary school. Anyway, a drug is any substance that affects the way your mind and body work.
This is your brain.
I drank some coffee before church. I will confess that to you. According to the DARE program I took in elementary school, caffeine is a drug. It affects the way my mind and body work. So not all drugs like are necessarily a sin. If you take medicine to help your body work, if you need insulin because you're diabetic, that's not a sin. But narcotics, things that affect the way that you perceive the world around you in a way that blurs things, if you need medicine like to help fight depression, that's fine. But if you're taking medicine that isn't prescribed by a doctor, just as a recreation, as a way to escape, that's sinful. Because God wants us to be sober-minded. He wants us to be aware of the world around us. He gives us healthy bodies and senses that need to be attuned to what's going on. Now, okay, well then, is alcohol a sin? Getting drunk.
If you're not 21.
Yeah, well, that's against the law.
That's against the law. So drugs that are against, yeah, go ahead, say it.
Boom, okay. Jesus, the Bible tells us that we should obey the law of the land we live in. Outside of alcohol and cigarettes and caffeine and like prescription drugs, narcotics are illegal. So it doesn't matter taking them. It disobeys the laws, so that's a sin. But even more, at the same time, a lot of drugs have a negative impact on our health. Well, that's not good. You shouldn't harm yourself.
That's not what God wants for you.
God gave you a body. It may not work the best from the start. A lot of people are born with like disabilities, but we shouldn't do anything to make it work worse. We ought to take care of what we got, be good stewards of what God gives us. And then beyond that, if you're using drugs as a means of escape, if you're turning to drugs, there's other things you could be turning to.
Yes.
If you become dependent on drugs, that's real bad because there's only one thing you should be dependent on. And his name is Jesus.
Amen. Yes.
So our understanding of sin is missing the mark, okay? If you're turning to illegal narcotic drugs instead of Jesus, you're missing the mark. If you're turning to caffeine and you, like, I have to have my Starbucks every morning or bad things will happen.
Now you're being convicting. Now you're...
That's not good. That might be something you need to work on in your life.
Yes, sir.
So it's, okay, so maybe I sort of misspoke. Is doing drugs a sin? Becoming dependent on them is a sin. And a lot of them, especially the illegal narcotic kind, are really easy to become dependent on, even if you do them just once.
That's right. Good. Excellent. Our next question is, response to 7, ISIS and eradication, I would fight back with you. I'm talking to you specifically, Chris and Marshall. Well, I don't know what, like, physical fight, I don't know. Let's go get them, guys. Well, I mean, I don't know if we would do much good right there.
So, okay, this sort of depends on the hypothetical situation. If a dude busted in the door right here and was like, I'm going to shoot everybody. Yeah, I'd fight back against that because I don't want him to shoot you guys. And we got kids here. Like, I would try to put myself between the danger and anybody else as best I could. I mean, from a personal standpoint, we can resist them. But if it's like one-on-one and this guy's like, okay, renounce Christ or I'm going to shoot you. No, shoot. Can I pray with you? I'm going to be praying as I go out. Would you like to be included in that or not? Too bad, bro. Lord, help this guy. Bang. I mean, I would definitely fight back, at least in the spirit. And if the situation made sense, in the physical realm as well.
We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but principalities and powers. Words of Paul. Right? So would we fight? Like, totally what he said. I don't want to, like, speak something I would do because in that moment, it's so scary. Like, I remember once I thought somebody had pulled out a gun and had shot it, and I was doing ministry. I was doing college ministry with some college students. I outran all those people, and I hid, and the whole time, I was like, oh my gosh, they're all dying, and I'm here just saving myself. I'm so useless. It turns out it was just a guy with a hammer, and he hit something metal. And I was just like, and I think I caused all the panic. I said, he's got a gun.
If your brother commits a sin that does not lead to death, pray for him. God will give him
church,
life.
Pray, church, pray. So, I mean, that said, I don't like to say what I would do. I would hope I would give my life for the people around me, okay? Try to stop them. I'm not necessarily like, now that I've stopped him, let's turn the gun on this sorry sucker and kill him. There's a line of where I will enter into the conflict, all right? We are told to wrestle, but not against flesh and blood. I would add to that how we fight is different from how the world fights. ISIS, we don't fight like ISIS. There's a movie called Machine Gun Preacher. I really like the movie. And it's a guy who's, he goes over to Africa where these people with guns are doing awful atrocities. You should see the movie. It's a great movie. But I really prayed about it. I don't know if I could do that. I don't feel like I could take up a gun and start shooting back at people, unless if it was to get them to stop. Like, I couldn't go out on raids to hit them before they hit me. Does that make sense? Yeah. So go see that movie. It's a good movie. But that's what we do.
Yeah. Thank you very much for this question. Thanks for paying attention. And
I'd fight for you. I think you would fight for me. You said I would fight back. Yeah, we'd fight for each other, I think. So that's it. I don't think we'd all march out here and say, let's go fight them all. Where are they at? Like that, I wouldn't recommend that. What's our next question here? I think this is our last one. All right. Question 15, as far as defending against terrorists, what about God saying, if you stand idly by while others are killed, their blood is on your hands. What about those in the military, the sword carried by governments appointed by God to deliver justice? Okay, well, last question. We got some big stuff here. So there, well, let's talk about the sword carried by the governments appointed by God to deliver justice. God uses nations often. Sometimes when he was going to correct Israel, how we'd correct Israel is, you got to listen to me, Israel. I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to help you. You don't want to listen to me? Okay, here come the Persians. And the Persians would ransack Israel. And so what did he use there? He used the Persians to do that, all right? Was that what he wanted to do? No, but that's what he did. There's a story, we told this at study group this last week. In 1917, the Turks had control over Israel. No, Israel was not a nation. There were no Jews living in the land of Israel. It used to be called Israel, basically. And so the Turks had control over that, and God moved in a miraculous way. A reconnaissance airplane flew over the area of Israel, and the Turks looked up, and they saw what was a British reconnaissance plane. They were just mapping the area, and they all got spooked, and the whole nation hightailed it out of there. The armies hightailed it out of there, and Britain's like, where's all the military? Where Britain walks in and says, well, I guess we have control over Israel now. What do you say we have all those people chosen by God to inherit this land come back to the land? That happened 99 years ago. Isn't that cool? God used Britain in that. So God totally does that. Say, I love that story. And standing idly by, I'm not saying that we should stand idly by while others are killed or even harmed, okay? We don't stand idly by. We defend. We enter into the fray, but we do our best to enter it in as Christ would. As Christ would. So, excellent.
If you feel called by God to go into the military, and you've been in prayer about this, and that's good. Do it. Live out your faith in Christ through the military. There's a lot of jobs in the military other than taking up arms, but even if that's where you end up, you can still do that in a way that glorifies God. If you get sent to do something that you don't agree with or like is opposed to your faith in Christ, it might take some strength to say, no, I'm not going to do that. But if we gave you the impression that, like, oh, the military.
We're not anti-military at all.
No, God bless them. Lord, be with the military. Help them. Lord, end these conflicts. Please. They've been going on forever. Lord, bring peace.
Yes.
I know that in this world, it's not a peaceful place, but still, Lord. So, we don't stand idly by. We can be in prayer for them. We can, if people are being killed, it's okay to try to do something in that situation. We don't attack, like, over and above what's needed to preserve life. We don't try to conquer, okay? Does that make sense?
Yeah. Also, sometimes there's times in history where people didn't get to choose if they were in the military. I know one such person, Dean, the last name, Dean, pastor, what was his first name?
Brother Dean.
He was a pastor, but he was drafted into the army in World War II. And he took on, what's the story?
He took in the infantry and he was trapped in Belgium.
He's in Belgium and he takes on an entire fleet of tanks. By himself, he takes them all down. He rescues the entire city. If you go to Belgium, they have a statue to Brother Dean right there in that city. And they all think the world of this Christian man who got to also go there and share his testimony of how he knew Christ after the war. Praise God for that. Praise God. War is awful. If you are in that hellacious environment, it's not what I would want for you. It's not what God wants for us. But you do your best, and you fight for the good. You fight the good fight of faith. You fight for the right, not the right to party, but you fight for the right of God. All right, cool. We are done with our questions. Thank you for all these questions. You keep sending those in. We'll keep answering them. Real quick, can we take some time to talk to God? We do three things every time we come together. We've worshiped together. We've received the word of God together. Third, let's take some time to talk to God. I invite you to take a step from your chair if you feel comfortable. If you don't, that's all right. You don't have to. But I want you to take some time where you're praying. Maybe something, we talked about some things about sin today. Maybe we talked about some issues that really brought some questions to your life. Why don't you ask God to come into
for more information about Redemption, look us up online at redemption-church.com. We want to hear from you, so be sure to connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, or even our anonymous question text line at 214-856-0550. Thank you for joining us, and have a blessed day.